What's going on, everybody? Here we are. It's another week at the Home Theater Hobbyist, and this week we have our review of the TCL 6 series. So let's get to it. Before we begin, I want to thank all of you for your support of the Home Theater Hobbyist thus far. If you aren't a subscriber, please subscribe and hit that notification bell so that you can find out when we upload new content. Also, if you want to support, look in the description below and you can see our Amazon link, our Patreon link, and link to our merchandise store so you can buy Home Theater Hobbyist merchandise. Now, let's get to the review. This is the TCL 6 series. This is the 55R615 to be more specific. It is a 55-inch TV in diagonal and it supports 4K resolution and HDR formats for HDR10 and Dolby Vision. It has wide color gamut support and it supports full array local dimming, which gives you 96 zones of contrast, so you get better blacks in more areas. Because it supports full array local dimming, it is a whopping 2.9 inches thick, which is thicker than some of your edge lit LED TVs, but you get better contrast. So I personally want better contrast, so I'll go for full array local dimming. This set actually has a brushed metal casing all the way around it, and it looks really good. I like brushed metal personally. It has a bezel that is about 1/4 inch thick along the top and the sides, and you have the bottom bezel down here that's just under 3/4 inch thick. Also along the bottom, you have the Roku TV logo down there on the left corner, the TCL logo here in the center, and that's it for logos. Under the TCL logo, you have a little plastic, piece down there for the remote reception. And over here on the right-hand side, you have a multifunction button. In my unboxing, I called that the power button, but it turns out it is actually a multifunction button. So let me show you how the multifunction button works. This multifunction button gives you a list of inputs for the television. So you just press it like that, and the list comes up. If you want to select something, you just press through and you get whatever you want. And once you select what you want, you just let it go and it does whatever you selected. Now the TV does not have a dedicated volume button, so you will have to use the included remote to change the volume. Now let's talk about this remote. If you're familiar with Roku, you are familiar with this remote. There's not very many changes. You have your power button up top along with your home and your back button, your D-pad for selecting things. You have a play pause down here in the center along with fast forward and rewind. And you have what I'll call your hot buttons for things like Netflix, Sling, Hulu, and DirecTV Now. Along the right hand side, you have your volume up and down and your mute button. On the back, you have a little indention so you can rest your finger and it feels nice. With this particular remote, you do have to point it at the TV for it to work. Let's talk wireless performance. This TV has a lot of built-in apps, and a lot of them even do 4K, including YouTube, Netflix, Amazon Prime, Vudu, and many others. And if you don't have an Ethernet cable, which we do recommend you use, but if you don't have an Ethernet cable, but you have a good wireless signal, this TV does pretty well. The Wi-Fi chip inside, or the Wi-Fi card, is 802.11ac, so it does get pretty good performance, and I didn't have any issues in my review period. Moving on to user interface, if you're familiar with Roku, you are familiar with this user interface because it's pretty similar. If you're not, we'll step through it just quickly just to show you a few things. This is the homepage. This is where all of your apps reside. So you just go through, you can go here, and you have your inputs here. This is already set up for what I like, but you have everything that you need right here on the homepage, and you can use the arrow menu to do whatever you want to do. Now, if you want to move an app or an input, you would just select the star or the option there, and you can move a channel, you can remove a channel, or you can close a channel. If you were to remove a channel, you would just click there, and then you can move it up, down, left, right, whatever you want to do, and you can click OK, and it stays there. So it's actually pretty self-explanatory. The rest of the things in the menu system include featured free content, my feed, the movie store by Fandango, so you can use your Fandango account. And you also have a search functionality, so you can search for movies, TV actors, and it'll find whatever you're looking for across the various apps. You can also download more streaming channels. Now let's quickly talk about the settings menu. The settings menu is where you're not only going to set up Roku-based stuff, but you're also going to set up the various things for the TV, including the picture settings and the audio. If you go into TV picture settings like we have here, you can set up each of the HDMI inputs and the antenna TV settings for the TV. So how the picture is going to look, if you're going to have a movie mode, a day mode, a night mode. You can set those up per HDMI setting. For the audio settings, you can come in here and you can change where the speakers are and also the menu volume. But if you are trying to do CEC control through the HDMI input 3, you need to go to a different setting. You actually need to go over to the system menu, and then you're going to go over to control other devices CEC. You can search for devices, and you can turn on audio return channel, or ARC, right there in the menu button. So that's how you're going to turn on your CEC control. One other hidden gem in the system settings menu is the power on functionality. If you go into power, you can actually change what happens when you turn the TV on. By default, you have the Roku home screen, so you'll have the home screen with your apps. But if you want to do something like last used TV input, like I have set up, you can do that, or you can change it to whichever HDMI you want. So that's just a nice little feature that they also include. One thing I'll mention after setup is it downloads two apps that I like, the 4K Spotlight app and the Dolby app. Both of these have 4K content, so you can instantly go in and watch 4K content as soon as you get your TV set up. Let's talk setup really quickly. Once you get this out of the box, you need to decide if you're going to wall mount it or use these included stands to mount this on the stand and put it on a television. The stands mount to the bottom of the TV and you can put it on a table like I have here. Or you can wall mount it using the included screws along the back of the TV. After that is complete, you'll turn the TV on and you'll go through the setup process where you join your wireless network and you sign into your Roku account or you sign up for a new Roku account. From there, it will download all your apps that you have selected or you already have on your account, and you're ready to go. Now let's talk about picture quality. And to assess the picture quality, I calibrated this set. I did a small calibration on this set. I calibrated the brightness, contrast, sharpness, and I also checked the screen uniformity. I did not touch color because the calibration disc I was using is based on Rec. 709 color, and this has wide color gamut, so I didn't want to mess with that, but I did check those basic things. Now, I'm not going to release my calibration settings because I am not a professional calibrator. If you want to find out settings from a professional calibrator, go to the ratings.com website and you can find it there. In fact, I'll include a link in the description below. But I will mention screen uniformity real quick because that is something that some people have asked about in the comment section. I was able to check my screen uniformity on this particular set and I did not have any issues. I've heard there are some issues from the ratings guys and their website, but I didn't have any issues with this set. So that is something to be a little bit concerned about, but for me, it worked out pretty well. Calibration is complete. Let's talk picture quality. I reviewed the picture quality using 4K content from the TV and also disc-based content. I also looked at 1080p content and DVD content. 4K looked the best, obviously, and DVD content looked the worst. But it did not look as bad as I thought it was going to look from DVD content. So if you have DVDs out there, I wouldn't be overly concerned about that. But let's talk 4K content. 4K content looks really good. I was watching the latest Avengers movie, Infinity War, and I was looking at that in 4K, and I also looked at the Blu-ray version. And the 4K version definitely gives you more detail and even the high dynamic range that the Blu-ray just doesn't have. So the images look a lot better. It definitely shines in 4K when I was watching on this set. Now, overall, I think the 4K looks really, really good. And even 1080p content looks really, really good. The blacks look good. They're not inky black like OLED, but they do look good. And I was a bit surprised by how good they did look on this set. So the picture quality of the set is actually really, really good. I wasn't expecting it to be as good as it was. So I was pretty happy to find out that the picture quality was better than my expectations, especially once I had it calibrated the way I need it calibrated for this particular room. Now let's talk audio quality. This TV has two speakers. They're downfiring and they are over here and over there. They are downfiring, so if they're sitting on a table, the sound will bounce off the table at you, and that's pretty nice. But honestly, these are flat screen TV speakers and they're not the best speakers in the world. They're passable, like you can definitely watch stuff on them. I'm not saying you can't. You can hear and you can turn it up and turn it down, and that's fine. But if you really want to get the best sound quality that you can, you need some sort of either soundbar or 5.1, 7.1 setup. And that's really what I recommend. They're passable, but you can definitely get better audio quality out of external equipment. So what's my recommendation? Well, overall, I do recommend this TV, especially for the price. You get 4K resolution, the major HDR formats, HDR10 and Dolby Vision. You get a Roku interface that works really well, that has 4K content built in right out of the box. You also get wireless performance that works really well. The only kind of downsides are the TV audio, which is pretty much the case with most flat panels, is not going to be great, and the screen uniformity issues as reported by ratings. I don't know how widespread that issue is, so I'm not overly concerned about it. And honestly, most people would never notice it because most people don't have test patterns. So if you're on the fence and you're kind of thinking about buying it, I think you should. It works really well, and I didn't have any issues with it whatsoever. Thank you guys for watching. Please like, subscribe, comment. Consider supporting us at patreon.com/hometheaterhobby or use that Amazon link in the description below, especially if you're trying to buy that TV. We'll talk to you next time.